Welcome to this video. In this video, we discuss CHSH inequalities. So these inequalities are also are a form of this EPR philosophy, where we get these inequalities by taking into account the reality and the locality aspect of the EPR. So let's revise the basic setup that we have been using. We will just use the same setup as we have used for this entire Bell inequality discussion. So we have two parties, Alice and Bob, and suppose Charlie somehow creates these correlated bits and supply one of the bit, that is one of the particle, to Alice and other to Bob. And this can be like classical correlations arising from conservation of angular momentum, or and further we can, in this setup, we can also think that the state, the bit that they are sharing, is this singlet state which we have been using all along. And so the point is, one of the parts, suppose the electron part of the state, or the first bit of this state, goes to Alice, and Alice has a Stern-Gerlach apparatus oriented along two different axes. Similarly, Bob also have along some different axes, BB prime. So the main point as per EPR is that, well, these properties of spins along these axes are inherent property or objective property associated with this particle, electron, for example. That means it doesn't matter whether I measure A or A prime. Measuring A doesn't mean that A prime doesn't exist. A prime always exists, and it has a deterministic value, either 1 or minus 1, without any superposition. So 1 minus 1 is a random variable. That A prime property or A prime value can take, but at a time it will take only one of the two, that is either plus 1 or minus 1. So same thing happens for A prime, B, B prime. So Alice measures this objective realistic property, and suppose she chooses to measure A and gets a value plus 1. But that doesn't mean that A prime measurement can't be done. A prime always exists whether she measures A or not. And this is the EPR argument. And further, we have seen these following expectation values that we have been calculating. So this expectation value is essentially the product. It is the product of two quantities, such that the first quantity is the value of spin along axis n1 for particle 1. So this outer part is for the particle, and second quantity is value of spin for particle 2 along axis n2. I could have also written n1 in both of them. That would have been value of spin for particle 1 along axis n1 and for particle 2 along axis n1. So anyway, each of the value of spin can be plus 1 or minus 1. So this product is a variable that can take value plus 1 or minus 1. And its expectation value over the singlet state, we have seen, is given by minus cos theta, where theta is the angle between this axis n1 and n2. So it is just the dot product. So this is the quantum mechanical result, and I remind again that as per the second video on Bell inequalities, we saw that this value, expectation value, which is essentially like Alice's measurement about n1 and Bob's measurement about n2, this can be said as, well, when will this entire value be plus 1? When either Alice gets a plus, and given Alice gets a plus, Bob gets a plus, or Alice gets a minus, given Alice gets a minus, Bob gets a minus, and it can be minus 1 when they get opposite signature bits. So this much we have seen already. And now the point is, in Bell inequalities, or even in the last video on these coins, thought experiment with coins, we saw that there were three axes involved for each party. Each party was measuring three coins, so there were three axes. So we try to achieve an inequality using two of the axes, A prime belonging to Alice and B prime belonging to Bob. So for that we define a new variable called C. This variable C is defined in this particular fashion. And here it is important to remember A prime, B prime. For defining this variable C, they are the values of spin. They are not the vectors. They are the values of spin along A, along B, along A prime, along B prime. And it is clear from the context that as this is a variable that is being defined, the value of spin is the only variable that we have at present. So with this we can arrange it like this, and it is now quite easy to see that when these A prime, B prime all are values that can either be plus 1 or minus 1, so when A and A prime are opposite to each other, A plus A prime cancels and this part remains, and similarly if A and A prime takes the same value like plus 1, then second term cancels, the first term remains, and B can be plus minus 1, B prime can be plus minus 1. That means C essentially is a variable that can only take value either minus 2 or plus 2. So plus 2 will come when B is equal to 1 and A equal to A prime equal to 1, and B prime can be anything. So similarly we can get the minus 2 value also. So what it essentially means is that the expectation value of C will be bounded by 2, because C is a variable that can either be minus 2 or plus 2, so its expectation value cannot exceed this maximum value of the variable. So what this means further is that we can simply take the expectation value, and this means that this C that we have can be written in this particular fashion, the expectation value of C, using the linearity of expectation like over addition, and this is less than equal to 2. And this inequality uses the fact that these variables that we are using, they are following this deterministic property that each of the variable always takes a definite value of plus 1 or minus 1. And so this is essentially a classical inequality, an equality that EPR predicts. And this inequality in this case is called Chsh inequality. These are the names associated to the people who derived this inequality. And now we look at the quantum mechanical violation of this inequality, as we have been always thinking of this. We saw the violation in Bell's case. So quantum mechanics easily violates this inequality. Suppose we take the singlet state psi and this A prime, B, P prime be the values of spin component about these axes that I have shown. This is the orientation of axes that I am specifying, because the Stern-Gerlach apparatus can be prepared in this way. So this is the preparation of the Stern-Gerlach apparatus. So if it is prepared in this fashion, then expectation of AB which is essentially this particular expectation, because AB are the values of the spin and here they are the axes. So it is clear from the context. So the angle between AB is 45, A prime B is also 45, AB prime, so AB prime is also 45, A prime B prime, it is 135. So minus cos of these angles can be directly put here, and we remember that here is a minus sign. So finally this gives us a 2 root 2 value. So for this particular preparation we get a value that is more than what EPR predicts, and hence EPR is violated. And by performing experiments one can see that indeed EPR is violated, and realism and localism is not what nature abides by. And further, this violation of 2 root 2 is special. To get this violation we used the singlet state, because you see we used the expectation values, and expectation values in quantum mechanics are with respect to some states, and here the state chosen was the singlet state. In turn, for any state if we try to calculate this expectation value, we see that it cannot exceed this value of 2 root 2 for the singlet state. I am not proving this result. The point is that this violation of 2 root 2 is the maximal violation, and hence we get an inequality that is quantum mechanical. That means that is true, that is what nature abides by. And this is the modified CHSH inequality that can be said to be a quantum version. So that's all for this video. In the next video we look at how this inequality provides us an important aspect or important resource, we can say, for playing these non-local games, particularly this CHSH game.